إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله جل وعلا، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، أجارني الله وإياكم من النار. As to what follows, all praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters in Islam, today is the first Friday of the school holidays. And I was thinking, what is an appropriate topic to discuss with everyone, the young and the old? What is something that is relevant for all of us? For I concluded in a few minutes that the topic that we are in most need of to hear about is to learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and what relationship are we supposed to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the greatest topic and the greatest knowledge on earth. And the greatest topic and the greatest knowledge in the heavens is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man huwa Allah? Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What relationship are we supposed to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the greatest knowledge on earth. The young is supposed to know about it, and the old is supposed to know about it. The poor and the rich are supposed to know. The man and the woman, everyone is supposed to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. My brothers and sisters in Islam, this topic of who Allah Azza wa Jal is a topic that requires struggle and effort and sacrifice just to learn something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if Allah Azza wa Jal was to give you something, if Allah Azza wa Jal was to give you some knowledge about who He is subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find ultimate peace and contentment and tranquility in your heart, in your soul, and in your mind. Allah Azza wa Jal, He tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah, a story about a man, أَوْ كَالَّذِي مَرَّ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ وَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا. There was a man in the past, no one saw him, he saw no one. Only Allah saw him, and Allah mentioned in the Quran the story of this man and what he went through. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, a man in the past, مَرَّ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ وَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا. He passed by a town, and the town, they say it was Baytul Maqdis, وَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا. At the time he passed by this town, it was خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا. It was ruined. It was destroyed. The walls had fallen down. The animals have perished and died. The water wells were useless. There was absolutely no one in this town. It was dead. A dead town, a ghost town. وَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا. This man, he was on his donkey, and he had his food and he had his water with him. So he passed by this town, and he said, he looked at everything dead, and he said, أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. He asked the question, how is Allah going to revive this town after he has died? How is Allah going to bring life to this town? Where would the water come out from? How would the trees grow? How would the crops grow? Where would life form in this town? أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. Immediately, right then and there, Allah Azza wa Jal wants to teach this man something. فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ. He's on his donkey, he fell off, he died. Allah caused death upon him. He died, his food fell off, and his donkey died as well. How many years? 100 years he died. ثُمَّ بَعَثَهُ فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ 100 years ثُمَّ بَعَثَهُ. After 100 years, Allah Azza wa Jal resurrected him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, كَمْ لَبِثْتْ. How long did you die for? How long? He answered, he said, قَالَ لَبِثْتُ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ. I think in my estimation, in my calculation, I probably was dead for half a day or one day. 100 years, look how time passes. Time is quick, it goes by really quick. He felt it like a day or half a day. Don't waste your time, time goes quick. قَالَ لَبِثْتُ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ. Allah Azza wa Jal said to him, بَلْ لَبِثْتَ 100 years. He died 100 years. Now, listen to what Allah said to him. He said to him, فَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِكَ وَشَرَابِكَ لَمْ يَتَسَنَّهِ. His problem was, his knowledge about Allah was limited. He was ignorant about Allah. When he came to a town, he questioned, how does Allah revive this? He doesn't know who Allah is. Allah wants to teach him something about himself. So Allah Azza wa Jal said to him, look at your food and your water. لَمْ يَتَسَنَّهِ, meaning لَمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ مَعَ مُرُورِ السِّنِينَ. That your food and your drink, look at it, it's still fresh as it is. It did not change by time. It did not change. It, you know, what's the miracle in this? That food is the quickest thing on earth that rots. You put a salad on the table now, come after 12 hours, it's gone. It's finished. You cannot eat it anymore. You put a fruit and open it up, 24 hours, less than that, it's rotten. No one eats it. The quickest thing on earth that rots, it's food. Wallah Azza wa Jal preserved his food. No refrigeration, no nothing, no preservatives. The food was preserved and fresh as it is, even though 100 years passed by. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِكَ وَشَرَابِكَ لَمْ يَتَسَنَّهِ. Allah Azza wa Jal, he said to him, وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ. Wasn't he on a donkey? The donkey had died. The donkey had been eaten by the earth. Nothing is left of the donkey, only a bit of pieces of bones, and they were scattered all over the place. For he saw his donkey. What was left of it? Only bones. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ الْعِظَامِ كَيْفَ نُنْشِزُهَا ثُمَّ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا. All of a sudden, this miraculous sight occurs and happens right before his eyes. The bones, they come to each other and they begin to form with each other. And then Allah Azza wa Jal begins to dress these bones with meat. كَيْفَ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا. And all of a sudden, his donkey rose and his donkey was alive once again, ready for him to ride on once again. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ وَلِنَجْعَلَكَ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ الْعِظَامِ كَيْفَ نُنْشِزُهَا ثُمَّ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا. By the end of all this, this man, he reached the conclusion. قَالَ أَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Finally, his conclusion was, now I know and I'm certain that Allah is capable over all things. My brothers and sisters in Islam, this is something you and I always say. Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. This man, he deserved to die 100 years to learn something about Allah. 100 years to learn something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To learn and to be certain that Allah is capable over all things. To you and I say, Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. But how much do you believe and how much are you convinced of this statement in your life? When trouble happens in your life, are you quick to say, Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir? When you fall in debt and you're worried, you can no longer pay your debt off. Do you say, Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir? When you're looking for marriage and you cannot get married, how certain are you? And you sit with yourself and you say, Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. How certain are you of that? You see, the statement is easy to say, but this man had to die 100 years to learn this lesson. Allahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. How much do you believe? How much are you certain in the fact that Allah is capable over all things in your life? Capable of removing all your worries and your sadness and your sorrow and your anxiety and your distress. How much are you convinced of this matter? Allah Azza wa Jal then goes on in the next ayah to teach us something about Ibrahim alayhi salam. And what did Ibrahim learn from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and about Allah? Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَإِذْ قَالَ Ibrahim alayhi salam, one of ulul azmi min al-rusul. This is a dignified noble from the best of the prophets to Allah Azza wa Jal. He stood one day and he said, Rabbi arini kayfa tuhyi al-mawta. Oh Allah, show me how you revive the dead. Ibrahim knows that Allah revives the dead. He's not asking, oh Allah, do you revive the dead? He's saying, oh Allah, show me how. How do you revive the dead? Because just two ayat before that, when he was with An-Namrud, he said to him, Rabbi alladhi yuhyi wa yumit. He's convinced, he knows. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who revives the dead. But Ibrahim alayhi salam wanted to go a step further in his knowledge with Allah Azza wa Jal. The knowledge that you have of Allah is not enough. Every day you're supposed to update your knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jal. فالعلماء رحمهم الله, they said, أراد إبراهيم أن يرتقي من علم اليقين إلى عين اليقين. Ibrahim عليه السلام, he wanted to advance. He has knowledge of certainty. He knows Allah revives the dead. But now he wants to see how Allah revives the dead. He wants to see the ability of Allah. فالله سبحانه وتعالى is pleased with this, and he wanted to show him. فالله عز وجل, he said to him, أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ? You don't believe. فإبراهيم عليه السلام, he said, بَلَى. Of course, certainly I believe that you're the one who revives the dead. وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. However, I want to feel satisfaction in my heart. I want to reach another level. I want some more knowledge of Allah عز وجل. My brothers and sisters in Islam, knowledge of Allah, you're supposed to seek it. You're supposed to do whatever is in your power to learn about Allah. He's the one who created you and the master and the provider and the sustainer. And you're satisfied with whatever knowledge you have. But what our problems is because we don't know who Allah is. And if you don't know who Allah is, why would you even turn to Him and ask Him? You will only dignify and honor a dua when you know who Allah is. For he said, وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. My heart, I want satisfaction. I want peace. I want tranquility in my heart. For Allah Azza wa Jal gives him an experiment, a project. He said, فَخُذْ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الطَّيْرِ. Go and collect four birds. Grab four birds. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. Any kind of bird. Ulama, they have long discussion what kind of bird he got. Some say a chicken, a goose, whatever it is. He got four birds. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. Chop them up. Cut them up. فَإِبْرَاهِيمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ chopped their heads off. Four heads. And then he ripped out the feathers. He broke the bones. He snapped them. Blood, flesh, meat all over the place. Four birds. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. Cut them all up. And you look at this. It's just the he is the one who disjointed all their bones. And if you gave him the task of putting them back together, no one would be able to do so. For then Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said to him, اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا. Go and put pieces, grab pieces of these chopped up birds and put them on top of a mountain. Some ulama say they were four mountains. Some ulama say that he had to go to the peak of seven mountains. Some said more than that. And I want you to understand that what Ibrahim is about to do, alayhi salam, is not a matter of an hour or two. The mountain of Everest, just to go to the top needs 2 months. 2 months to get to the top. And then to come down, it requires from you 4 weeks, yani 1 month. And this is the mountain of today, the Mount Everest. Back in the past, mountains were taller than what they are today. Today they've become small. Erosion has made them small in size. So you can imagine what task is on the hand of Ibrahim alayhi salam. اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا. So he began to take pieces and go all the way to the top of a mountain. Hardship, difficulty. Imagine that you climb a mountain. It's not an expedition. People die when they go up the mountain of Everest. But he's doing what he can to learn something about Allah. So he goes up to the top of the mountain and he puts a piece. and to another, come down, go back on another mountain. Come, Allahu A'lam, how long this took. Months, years. ثُمَّ جَعَلْ عَلَى كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِّنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا. And he had the four heads with him. The heads were kept in his hand. Then he went back down. Then Allah Azza wa Jal said to him, ثُمَّ ادْعُهُنْ. Call them now. Say, O birds, come. يَأْتِينَكَ سَعْيَا. والعلماء المفسرون رحمهم الله, they say, and as Ibrahim is standing and calling these birds to come, he sees with his own eyes the drop of blood go from this mountain to the other mountain. The bones from this mountain go to the other mountain. And a bird begins to form. The feathers fly from this one to this. Each feathers go back to the same bird it is. Not a drop of blood that was for another bird ends up in another bird. Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about the human beings like this. قَدْ عَلِمْنَا مَا تَنْقُصُ الْأَرْضُ مِنْهُمْ وَعِنْدَنَا كِتَابٌ حَفِيظٌ. You know, when mankind die, the millions and the billions of mankind that have died, when Allah resurrects us, the cell that was in your liver doesn't end up in your heart. The drop of blood that was in your kidney doesn't end up in this finger. All of it goes back to where it came from. ثُمَّ ادْعُهُنْ. Call them. يَأْتِينَكَ سَعْيَا. All of a sudden, these four birds, they started to come down to him, headless with no head. And he began to extend the head. And if he gave the head to the wrong bird, it would refuse to take it. Until he handed over the right head, and it became connected like a Lego. It came back to its head. Then what was the entire project? Yeez. What was the conclusion? وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Two names of Allah. To reach two names of Allah, you had to do all this. How serious are you about Allah's names? How serious are you about the names of Allah? About who Allah is? وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Finally, Allah gave him peace and tranquility. Allah gave him knowledge about Allah because he strived. He struggled. He went up a mountain and down. He was ready to give his whole life to learn something about Allah. In the end, he got two names only. In the end, he got to be convinced about two names. He saw by his own eyes. يَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ. Allah is powerful. Allah is the mighty. Allah is capable over all things. Aziz. To him belongs the law, and to him belongs all worship. This is from the name Al-Aziz, Al-Hakim, the All-Wise. Ya Ibrahim, don't ask about why I gave you four birds and so on. Ana Al-Hakim, I am the All-Wise. I tell you, do something, you do it. And if that is to chop four birds and put them on mountains, do it. Don't question. And if Allah is telling you, pray at this time, pray on this time. Don't question. Otherwise, you will never experience the name of Allah, Al-Aziz, Al-Hakim in your life. Just do it. Allah says, wear the hijab, just do it. Allah Azza wa Jal wants you to keep your beat, just do it. Do it. Allahu Aziz, Al-Hakim. People are ready to give their life to learn something about Allah. And you know, at the time, it's not like Ibrahim had a lot of time. At his time, there were kuffar. There were people that required da'wah. There were people that were desperate to listen about Allah. But Allah Azza wa Jal, in his infinite mercy and wisdom and knowledge, says to Ibrahim, go and learn about Allah first. Go and do this for many years. Doesn't matter if your people don't see you. People, they're not, Allah Azza wa Jal is biyadihi kullu shay. Allah is the one who guides. The prophets are just means. They go around, tools of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what we are as well. Yani, don't begin to justify one thing over another. Yani, I know, wallah, I don't have time to learn about Allah because 1, 2, 3. Was there a much more important job to give da'wah to the people? Even that wasn't an excuse for Ibrahim not to learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had knowledge of Allah like no one else. وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ. Ibrahim, Allah Azza wa Jal allowed Ibrahim to see the kingdom of Allah in the heavens. In the tafsir of this ayah, ulama, they say Allah showed him the arsh. And he saw the angels. And he saw al-qalam. He saw everything of Allah's kingdom that is in the heavens. And he saw everything of Allah's kingdom on the earth. وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ. And he had deep conviction and certainty of Allah. So why is he asking Allah, أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى? The idea of knowledge about Allah continues to develop in a person. No matter how much of a scholar or knowledgeable you are, knowledge of Allah should never ever end in your life. Always pursue after this knowledge. Learn about this knowledge. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created you. People today are worried. People today have problems. People today are in all sorts of problems. Wallah, there is not a single house on earth except that there are problems in it and issues. Currently, right now, there are divorced women sitting in the house waiting to get married. There are people that are in debt. They have been overridden by debt. There are people that are sick. There are people, there are fathers that their sons have rebelled upon them and the father can't wait to see his son dead. And there are children that don't want to know their parents anymore. These are all problems that we're living. All of these problems are solved if you knew who Allah Azza wa Jalla is. Well, the problem, we're still in our problems because we haven't recognized who Allah is. As a result, we've never turned back to Him. Understand, learn about Allah. And once you know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, turn to Allah in a dua. Allah Azza wa Jalla is al-Ghafoor, al-Rahim, al-Kareem, al-Mu'ti. Allah al-Kareem, the generous. Allah will look after your affairs. You know, one thing you learn every single day is something about the generosity of Allah. Every single day we see it. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal, for every worship that we do, He multiplies it. This is from His generosity. Just not long ago, we finished Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr, khayrun min alfi shahr. Look at the generosity of Allah. He said to you, you give me a few hours in worship, I'll give you a lifetime of worship in your account. What's this? Hadha karamullah. This is the generosity of Allah. Allah says to you, pray 12 raka'at in one day without the fard, as sunnah ratiba, and I'll make you a house in the paradise. Allah says, say subhanallah once, and I'll give you the mountain, the size of the mountain of Uhud of hasanat. Say subhanallah wa bihamdih. That is a palm tree in the paradise. Shuf al-karam. Look at the generosity of Allah. Now for the point. This is the point. That if this is Allah's generosity to us in our matters of worship, which are the most important matters in life, you think Allah would be stingy upon you in matters of a dunya that are pathetic, that are useless, that are inferior to the matters of the worship? Allah Azza wa Jalla is generous upon us when it comes to matters of worship, which are the matters that will save us on the day of judgment. You think He won't give you a dunya? If you turned and you asked Him, you think that He'll hold it back? This is what we're supposed to learn. We're supposed to come and recognize karamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maryam alayha salam, she was in her house in Baytul Maqdis, a young girl. Zakariya alayhi salam enters upon her and he sees that she has summer fruit during winter time, even though there's no refrigeration and no preservatives at the time. What is summer fruit doing in your house in winter time? And then he would find winter fruit in her house during summer. What's that doing there? So he said to her, Ya Maryam, Anna laki hadha. Where do you get all this from? The answer is simple. Qalat huwa min indillah al-kareem subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave her what he wants from this worldly life because she devoted herself in worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She said, this is all from Allah. Inna Allah yarzuqu man yasha bighayri hisab. Allah gives who He wills without taking him to account into anything. لأن الدنيا بيد الله It's all in the hands of Allah. Right then and there, Zakaria alayhi salam, when he seen this, he got affected. By this time, Zakaria is about 90 years old. He's already a prophet. This is a young woman who taught a prophet something. Something about Allah. He got inspired. And he has been wanting a child for a very long time. Many years he's been making dua for a child. Allah says, "Hunalik," right then and there, da'a Zakariya Rabbah. He put his hands up, "Ya Rabb," and he made a dua, "Habli min ladunka dhurriyatan tayyibah." Give me a righteous offspring. And I'm old. The bones have become weak. The hair of my head has become white. I'm on the doorstep of death. My wife is barren. Impossible situation. But oh Allah, you make what is impossible possible. When you provided summer fruit during winter, that is something impossible in our calculation. To Allah, it's not impossible. So he made a dua. Habli min ladunka dhurriyatan tayyibah innaka sami'u dua. That's it. He knew who Allah was and he made a dua after it. Immediately Allah Azza wa Jal answered him and he gave him Yahya alayhi salam. Yahya was on his way. And then Zakariya alayhi salam asked Allah, "Anna yakunu li walad?" How can I have a child? How? Allah Azza wa Jal said to him, "Kadhalika Allah." That's it. That is Allah. "Qala kadhalika qala rabbuka huwa alayya hayyin." Easy, it's easy upon Allah. But you think Allah Azza wa Jal cannot solve your issue? "Huwa alayya hayyin." That's it. "It is easy upon me." "Waqad khalaqtuka min qablu wa lam taku shay'a." I created you much before this and you are nothing. Hada Yahya, at least he's coming after a mother and father came in contact with each other. Karamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have we taken advantage of Karamullah? Have we taken advantage of the generosity of Allah? When an issue happens in life, did you turn to Allah and make dua? Did you invest in the times in where dua is accepted to turn and raise your hand and say, "Oh Allah"? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was affected by anything in life, you know what he'd do? كَانَ إِذَا حَزَبَهُ أَمْرٌ فَزَعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Any distress he would feel, any difficulty he would feel, he would rush to as-salat. Allahu Akbar ya Rabb. And you know this hadith, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not narrate it. As-sahaba told us that's what he did. In other words, they've seen it enough from him to say this is how he was. It wasn't his words. It was him being described. And this is serious. Any issue that would happen, he'd rush to as-salat. لأنه he knew that everything is in the hand of Allah. And if Allah wants something to happen, all he says, "Kun fayakun," that's it. Almost all of a sudden, the problems disappear. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to him belongs all things. Turn to Allah in times of struggle and difficulty. Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, "Salu Allah kulla shay." Ask Allah everything. Hatta shisa', even if it was a shoelace. You know, if you walk and your shoelace gets ripped, ask Allah for a shoelace. In a narration as well, it said, "Hatta al-milha fi al-ta'am." Ask Allah for salt in the food. Why? She says at the end of the hadith, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ إِن لَمْ يُيَسِّرْهُ لَمْ يَتَيَسَّرْ. Because if Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't make it possible, no one can make it possible. If Allah doesn't make it possible, if the entire world was to come together to make it possible for you, it will not happen. Therefore, ask Allah everything. Subhanallah. And so when something happens, who do you turn to first? The one who doesn't know Allah will not turn to Allah. Innama, the one who knows Allah and continues to pursue after this knowledge would know when something happens, immediately faza'a ila salah, Allahumma ya Rabb, and Allah would solve his problem. This is the kind of knowledge we're supposed to have. Get to know Allah Azza wa Jal's generosity. One final hadith, my brothers in Islam. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he says لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم Allah, this is a hadith Qudsi paraphrased by Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, if the first and last of you, everyone from Adam alayhi salam until the last man on earth, wa insakum wa jinnakum, mankind and al-jinn kind, were to all stand in one plane, as-sa'id is the earth, and all of them in one time were to ask Allah, fasa'aluni, they asked me, and how many things do you want? Each and every single one of us here, how many things do you want? Imagine this. Imagine one person just asks, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kullih. Just this one question. Oh Allah, I ask you from all kinds of goodness. If just this is from one person, then imagine you have the billions of people asking this same question. Now, so you can draw this image closer. Imagine I was to join all the world leaders of the world and all the kings and all the multimillionaires. And I say to you, come, ask them what you want. And you just ask them this one question. Inni as'alukum min al-khayri kullih. Would they be able to fulfill this? We're speaking about the entire world. If you ask them, as'alukum min al-khayri kullih, they wouldn't be able to satisfy you with it. Imagine every single mankind was to ask Allah this question. فَأَعْطَيْتُ كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مَسْأَلَتَهِ. And Allah was to give everyone exactly what they asked for and desired. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, مَا نَقَصَ ذَلِكَ مِنْ مُلْكِي إِلَّا كَمَا يَنْقُصُ الْمِخْيَطُ إِذَا أُدْخِلَ الْبَحْرِ. This will, if Allah was to give you everything you asked for, multiply it by billions and billions of the creation, mankind and jinnkind, it will only decrease from Allah's kingdom that which, if you were to put a pin in the ocean and take it out, how much water would stick to it? Nothing. Yani it does not decrease from Allah's kingdom, nothing. How come we haven't seen this? Because we don't know who Allah is. And we don't turn to Him in dua. Learn, my brothers in Islam, that when you need something, you turn to Al-Kareem subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one who gave you and fed you before your mother even fed you. When the umbilical cord and you were sucking on it, your mother didn't even feed you yet, Allah was looking after you. Warm, protected. Then when you came out, your parents are rushing left and right to keep you warm and protected. Allah Azza wa Jal did that for a service for free. This is your Lord. Turn to Him when you need something. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وبعد. هذا وصلوا وسلموا رحمكم الله على خير البرية وأزكى البشرية محمد بن عبد الله صاحب الحوض والشفاعة. فقد أمركم الله تعالى بأمر بدأ فيه بنفسه وثنى بملائكته المسبحة بقدسه وأيه بكم أيها المؤمنون، فقال عز من قائل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم، واشكروه على نعمه يزيدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون.